Hi there. In this, the final part of my Frost tutorial, I'm going to cover how we render out three sets of image sequences and then how to combine them together into the final animation. So it should be pretty straightforward, but I will show you some of the advantages of rendering in this way rather than trying to composite all together. So at the end of the last tutorial, we quickly rendered out the scene and composited the three sets of images into the final image. So you can see here, that's our mask render layer. There's our no frost render layer. And there is our frost render layer. I was playing around with using a color ramp, but that's currently muted, which is why it's in red. If you press M, it unmutes it. And you can see it's a slightly different effect. Because of the way I've got it set out, it actually cuts out some of the frost. But it's up to you whether you use that. That mask layer is being used to control which of the images is displayed, the one without frost or the one with frost. That's being mixed together, and then we just send that out to the composite. Now we could, of course, just render all of that straight out. But if you later on decide you want to change some of the look, so you might want to change the hue of the frost perhaps, make the scene go a little bolder color as the frost develops, that's not so easy to do. Certainly not so easy to do in the way we might like to do it. So in other words, just where the frost is to have it cooler. You can obviously change the overall hue of the scene fairly easily when you render out the video. So what I did is I actually created a new file and then took what I'd created from this one and combined it in there. So just a quick note on how to render that out. Strongly suggest, especially for something like this and where the scene takes a little while to render, this one's currently taking 53 seconds to render, but that's only at 50%. So that's a quarter of the resolution of that really. You don't need RGBA, but just set it to RGB. Generally speaking, color depth of 8 is fine. If you find you're getting a lot of anti-alias patterning in things like the sky, you may want to try 16, but the key thing to do if you're getting a lot of anti-alias patterning is to come down to post-process and turn on a little dithering, and generally that would sort it out. Obviously we need to select whatever settings are working for us here for the speed of the render. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail on that. But the most important thing is our output. So what I did is I rendered them out into three separate folders. So here you can see the version of the scene with frost in it. Under here, the same scene but with no frost. And under this folder, what I called mask, you can see the version of the scene that just has where the frost needs to be in it. And you can see that how that's animating. I just set that away from date format and you can now see that they're progressing. So you can see how the frost is developing in the scene. There are ways to do it all in one go. But all I did was I didn't use any of these other inputs. I just, for example, to render the mask, I just took that straight to there, set my output to my mask folder, gave it a name, something like mask 1. And usually I put a dash on the end of it because when you render an image sequence, Blender automatically puts a numerical file extension on the end, which is very handy. I use PNG. That's not completely uncompressed, but it's a pretty good balance between the quality of the final image and the size of the file. They're still pretty reasonable size files. You can go for other formats and you can give those a go if you're having problems with compression noise. And you can control the level of compression here anyway, but you'll soon find you're using a lot of disk space up with this sort of thing. So set it to RGB, generally color depth of 8 is fine. Compression, I think the default is 15% and that's fine, and PNG works for me. Don't use JPEG or anything like that, unless it's just a draft version of the file that you're creating, in which case you could probably just render to AVI JPEG. So I just connected that like that, clicked animation and Blender whirred away for a few hours and created the first sequence. Then I just simply attached the next sequence. Very important now, change the folder and the name. So change it to, in this case, it would have been no frost. Render that, and then finally do the same for this third one. There are options for creating files automatically, but again, you may want to just do one section, have a look at that, and then see if everything was working okay, the animation or whatever, before you then go and render the next, especially if it's taking a long time to render. I use this little application called DJV View. All it does is it allows you to open image sequences. So if I select this one, you can see the memory is loading there. And then finally we start to get frost appearing. You can see the frame rate up here is pretty close to the target frame rate. And once it's gone through, as long as it's got enough buffer, I've allowed 8 GB of buffer, and then it'll just go through, generally speaking, at normal frame rate. So that's a good way to preview your animation without having to composite it or compile it into a video. That's called DJV View, and I'm sure there are other tools out there that'll do it. So I'll generally preview the things as they're going along, produce my three sets of image sequences, and then I started a new file. So we'll do that now. I'm just going to say new, and we don't actually need the 3D viewport per se, but I will open a new window up, and we need the node editor. We'll switch to the compositor, press N to get rid of that right hand menu, and we'll say use nodes, and we get our basic composite output and our render layer input. So I'm going to remove the render layer input, and I'm going to add an input which is an image sequence. I'm going to use the files I already created. So we'll start with the frosty scene, and we'll import that, and we'll press A to select everything and say import image sequence. And there it is. And you can see it's automatically, because I selected all the frames, it already knows there are 600 frames and to start at frame one. You can obviously change that if you need to. I put auto refresh on, which I think just means if you've got some renders going on elsewhere, perhaps you've got another computer or another instance of Blender going and it's updating files, that it will automatically pick the updates up rather than just working on what's in memory. It's up to you whether you turn that on. So if we just connect the image straight to the output and I press F12 to render, instantly there's our scene. And if I scroll through the timeline, you can see it's scrolling through our scene. So that's great. There's our frosty scene. So now I just need two more. We'll put that one there and I'll put another copy there. So I'll just shift D to copy them. So the top one I'm going to use for my mask, and the middle one I'll use for the no frost scene. So if I connect my mask to the output, we come on a little bit later. There it is. You can see some frost being created. I should have said, although these are 600 frames long, the default, of course, with Blender is only 250 frames. So we need to set that to 600 frames down there as well now. In my particular case, that's the number of frames I rendered. And if I connect that one, we can see our no frost scene. So it's all going quite well at the moment. So we now need to combine them together. So I'm going to add a color mix node, much as you'd expect. I'll drop that in there and put the frosty version on the other side. So all the way to the left, no frost, all the way to the right, frost. Now take my mask and connect that into the factor. And already you can see we've got areas where there's frost and areas where there isn't. I now add converter, which is a color ramp. Just really duplicating what I did. This is entirely up to you now. I set the low end to 0.025 and the higher end, or the white end, to 0.655. There we go. So you can see we've got our scene starting to build up. And if I just move through, you can see the frost is taking over. But that's quite a good place to hover around, I think. And then all I did was just add a few more nodes, because you can at this stage, and make some slight changes. So let's move these two back a little bit. And the first additional node I added was a color balance node to each of those. So the no frost one, I took slightly warmer, perhaps a little bit more than that. You can see this area is becoming slightly redder. The frosty scene I took in the other direction. I took slightly cooler. So essentially you've got that contrast between what appears to be slightly warmer and what appears to have cooled. It's basically slightly bluer. It's perhaps not strictly photographic, so you don't necessarily have to do that, but it just gives you that feeling that the scene is cooling down as the frost is developing. I then added a few more nodes just to tweak it a little more. So I added a hue saturation node into the frosty version of the scene, and I actually turned the saturation down slightly to 0.75, so as if colour's draining out of the scene a little bit, and you can see how that frost became a little whiter. And then added a brightness and contrast node, and I set brightness to 0.1. So again, that just brightens that frost up a little bit. I then put in another colour mix node, and just drop that there. All of this in the frost version. Set this one to add. It's just going to go white at the moment. Set that to black and that won't do that. I'm going to add filter, which is a glare filter. Take the output of the brightness and contrast node into there, and then take the output of the glare filter into the other side of that add node. It's literally brightened it up. And I set this to fog glow. Left it on medium, but I put a mix of one. So if we just have a look at what that does. In fact, if I take it all the way to the final output, and then I'll set the threshold down to 0.15. You can see that the brightest parts of the scene are the only parts coming through. Remember, this is being added to the frosty version. So I now put that into there, all it'll do is where there is frost, it will just highlight it a little bit, maybe even give a slight glow to it. And I set the size to 9, so slightly larger. So again, it's just to give that slightly frosty, foggy feeling to the scene without it really being in your face. And then finally, just to give something that is often added is a vignette. So a vignette is where it gets dark around the corners and it helps to focus the attention on the middle of the scene and adds a certain variation to the scene as well, which is pleasing to the eye. So I'm going to add a matte node, which is an ellipse mask. To begin with, just drop it straight into there and you'll get an ellipse appear. Set the width to 1 and the height to 0.5. Having set it up, we can just take it back out again. We need another mix node. Drop that there. We'll set this to multiply. We'll connect the mask into the other side. And you can now see we've got essentially a vignette, but it's rather a harsh vignette at the moment. So we now have to add a blur node. Drop that in there. Set it to fast Gaussian. Say relative, which allows for the aspect ratio of the scene to be corrected. So if we say Y, it will know that it's a wide scene rather than a high scene. And we'll set this to 15% for each one. And then finally, we can play with the mix, because that's quite an extreme vignette at the moment. It depends on how dramatic you want the scene to look. And perhaps we just go with 0.85, and now it's a much more subtle vignette, but it gives a pleasing variation to the scene. And that's all there is to it. And all you then need to do, obviously, is render that out to a new image sequence. But the point is, if you decided you weren't happy, perhaps, with the way the mask was working, and you wanted to redo that, all you'd need to do is re-render your mask image sequence and then re-render this sequence, and the whole thing is updated. You haven't got to re-render all of these again. Plus, of course, you can play around with color balance on the individual elements, which would not be possible to do except at render time if you did it all in one go. So it gives you that increased flexibility. So I know that was very short, but hopefully that's given you some ideas on how you can use compositing in your own scenes, and hopefully perhaps go and make some frosty scenes of your own. Hope you found that useful. If you did, let me know. I look forward to your comments, and I'll see you in the next tutorial. Bye for now. So I hope you found that interesting. If you did, let me know. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe. I also have a Facebook page and a Twitter account, and I now have a Patreon page as well, and I'll provide links to all of those in the description below. So I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.